Tony's ready. He didn't see you at the lecture. Oh,
good morning, everybody, and welcome to the monastery. My name is Ros Rundle. Our celebrant this morning is Father Tony. Today is the 30th Sunday in Ordinary Time, Year C. Now, you will have noticed that there are census cards on the pews, so please complete the form and place it on the collection plate, or otherwise there is a box at the entrance to the church where you can put that. And we acknowledge and pay respect to the Kaurna people as the original and ongoing owners and custodians of this land on which we gather. We commit ourselves to actively working alongside First Nation peoples for reconciliation and justice. And this morning's Mass is being offered by Father Tony for Anna Onfrio on the 30-day anniversary of her death. Would you please stand now and join in the opening hymn and welcome Father Tony.
Together this morning, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God our Father, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with all of you. Good morning, everyone. We could remember particularly in our prayer this morning, Anna Onofrio. Anna was buried from this church here just 1 month ago. And we could also, we've probably all brought our own intentions and desires, what we might receive from this Mass. We might remember a six-month-old baby who was very sick. And I think also the people who are affected by the floods in other parts of Australia. So we bring those requests before God. Perhaps just take a moment to be aware of, what do I bring? I want to receive from this. What do I bring to this prayer? Lord Jesus, you came to reconcile us to the Father and to one another. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
You heal the wounds of our sin and division. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
You pray for us with the Father. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sin, and bring us into everlasting life.
Amen.
Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to people of good will. we praise you, we love you, we adore you, we glorify you. We give you thanks for your great glory. All God, heavenly King, and our almighty Father, Lord Jesus Christ, and his Lord's Son, Lord God, and of God, Son of the Father, take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Take away the sins of the world, seek our prayer.
You are seated at the right hand of the Father, have mercy on us.
You are the Lord of our God, you are the Lord of our Lord, you are the Lord of our God, Jesus Christ,
in the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen.
And let us pray. Almighty and ever-living God, strengthen our faith, our hope, and our love. May we do with loving hearts what you ask of us and come to share the life you promise. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, for ever and ever. Amen. After the Gospel this morning, Father Dennis will just give a short report on the finances of the parish.
A reading from the book of Ecclesiastes. The Lord is a judge who is no respecter of personages. He shows no respect of personages to the detriment of a poor man. He listens to the plea of the injured party. He does not ignore the orphan's supplication, nor the widow's as she pours out her story. The man who with his whole heart serves God will be accepted. His petitions will carry to the clouds. The humble man's prayer pierces the clouds. Until it arrives, he is inconsolable. Nor will he desist until the Most High takes notice of him, acquits the virtuous and delivers judgment. And the Lord will not be slow, nor will he be dilatory on their behalf. The word of the Lord. The Lord hears the cry of the people. I will bless the Lord at all times, his praise always on my lips. In the Lord my soul shall make its boast, the humble shall hear and be glad.
The Lord hears the cry of the poor.
The Lord turns his face against the wicked to destroy their remembrance from the earth. The just call and the Lord hears and rescues them in all their distress.
The Lord hears the cry of the poor.
The Lord is close to the brokenhearted. Those whose spirit is crushed, he will save. The Lord ransoms the souls of his servants. Those who hide in him shall not be condemned.
The Lord hears the cry of the poor.
A reading from the second letter of St. Paul to Timothy. My life is already being poured away as a libation, and the time has come for me to be gone. I have fought the good fight to the end. I have run the race to the finish. I have kept the faith. All there is to come now is the crown of righteousness reserved for me, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will give to me on that day, and not only to me, but to all those who have longed for his appearing. The first time I had to present my defence, there was not a single witness to support me. Every one of them deserted me. May they not be held accountable for it. But the Lord stood by me and gave me power, so that through me the whole message might be proclaimed for all the pagans to hear. And so I was rescued from the lion's mouth. The Lord will rescue me from all evil attempts on me and bring me safely to his heavenly kingdom. To him be glory forever and ever. Amen. The word of the Lord.
Spoke the following parable to some people who prided themselves on being virtuous and despised everyone else. Two men went up to the temple to pray, one a Pharisee, the other a tax collector. The Pharisee stood there and said this prayer to himself: "I thank you, God, that I am not grasping, unjust, adulterous, like the rest of humankind, particularly that I'm not like this tax collector here. I fast twice a week. I pay tithes on all I get." The tax collector stood some distance away, not even daring to raise his eyes to heaven, but he beat his breast and said, "God, be merciful to me, a sinner." This man, I tell you, went home again at rights with God. And the other did not. For everyone who exalts themselves will be humbled, but the one who humbles himself will be exalted. The Gospel, the good news of the Lord.
Good morning to everyone, and thank you, Father Tony. As has been mentioned in the bulletin for a few weeks, I wanted to give an update to everyone today. My apologies to Anna's family. We don't talk about money very often. I'm sorry that today we are, and to all of who are watching us at home, although your help and contribution would also be helpful today. So I have some slides. Don't be too worried about the detail or the words. They're more to help us understand. I have a somewhat mixed experience of dealing with finances. I have a distinct memory as a child, very small child, being given a coin by my parents to put on the collection plate. But if you can appreciate the mind of a little boy, that seemed a very precious thing, and I didn't really want to give it. With a lot of encouragement from Mum and Dad, I actually did put the coin in, but I thought, while I'm down there, I might grab some more, so I replaced it. Could have been a turning point in my life, who knows. Now, more seriously, today I want to begin with a word of thanks to everyone who does support the parish. And I'm speaking mostly now today of our second collection, the collection that helps the parish. And there's great generosity, and for many, many people that's extended for the course of their life, and generations even of the same families supporting us. And that makes it possible to do what the parish does. So the second collection supports all of the parish facilities, helps us to maintain our mass centres, all the administration of the parish, the employment, secretarial help, pastoral associates. The collection helps us to assist our parish school. And the collection makes it possible for people like Father Tony or myself, Father Jacob, Father Tony, and the men who've worked before us to help in all of the areas that we look after as a parish, the nursing homes, 13. We give a small contribution to the gardens as a parish to help keep the atmosphere. We support the Vincent de Paul Society as a parish, and generously each Christmas, the Hamper Appeal, the Brother Michael Hamper Appeal, which makes a difference to sometimes up to 400 people for Christmas. Our parish finances underpin everything we do. We go to a hospital, we have to park, we have to pay. All of this is the work of the parish. The finances of the second collection help maintain all the administration costs of a parish. The list on the slide is extensive, but it's like your home budgets. In our case, we have to pay salaries, of course, but telephone, water, electricity, rates, taxes, insurance, all of these things, fuel for the cars, all are helped by our parish contributions. The contributions make it possible to do all the admin work of the parish. We have to keep records at every baptism, wedding, funeral, confirmation in this parish. We have to maintain them from the day the parish began until this day. We have a sacramental program that we have to fund and provide for the children of our school and for the neighbourhood, those who wish to receive the sacraments of baptism, confirmation, Eucharist. We prepare families for baptism. Our finances also make possible all the sacramental life of the parish, providing for everything. And as is instanced today with the world we're living in, we also pay for internet and all of the IT costs. The parish collections make it possible for us to be a good part of the Archdiocese. We're responsible to the Archbishop. We are part of the Archdiocese of Adelaide. We have costs and taxes that we pay to the central funds so that the work of the Archdiocese can continue, and each parish is taxed according to its capacities. And we support, mostly through the first collection, and I'm not talking about that today, we support the Passionist community. I don't know what happened then. It's just gone off. I'll keep talking and maybe we'll get back. Perhaps we haven't paid our IT bills. I'm not sure. I don't know what's happened to us there. The first collection helps the community. We don't receive a wage. We depend on your generosity. The priests of Adelaide always are paid and employed by the Archbishop, but we are not. The first collection, which I won't speak about today, I really need to talk to you about the second collection. Thank you. So let's hope nothing goes wrong. So I begin with thanks, but also have to be honest and upfront with everyone. COVID has really tested us, like everyone, over the past 2 years. We've had many challenges, times of uncertainty. We've had the church closed, we've had reduced numbers, we've had protocols in place. We've had no collections, essentially, for 2 years. Vastly reduced attendance rates at masses. Many people, even still, don't feel comfortable, don't feel ready, perhaps have even become used to not having Sunday Mass. COVID added also to the costs. Some of the symbols you can see behind me there. Buying gel every week, buying boxes of masks. All of these, they're a small cost, although at $50, $60, $70 a week they mount up. But I think what's really happened mostly to us is reduced attendances, and that has substantially also reduced our income. hope the figures are clearer for you. You can see in 2019 that we essentially were close to our own budget. Small overrun, but we can manage that. I've left out 2020 because it distorts the picture. 2020, the federal government of Australia paid JobKeeper to every charity, every organisation, every business, and including the Catholic Church, so that we could maintain our staff, pay our wages. So they paid around $70,000 to help the parish. At the same time, the Archbishop reduced every cost to the parish, didn't ask for any contributions whatsoever. So there, perhaps $20,000 or $50,000 was saved. So that year is quite distorted. But you can see that last year, so even though we reduced our expenditure about $33,000 as best we can, you can see that our income fell by nearly 70,000. And that results, the red line being our expenditures and the black line being our income. That results at the end of last year at nearly $40,000 deficit to the parish. And projected, because we haven't finished the year yet, but you can see that that gap is getting wider and wider. We can cover last year's debt and indeed this year's debt by withdrawing most of our savings as a parish. So there's no crisis at this minute, but we can't sustain that into the future. We won't have that money to pay next year. By the end of 2023, if we can't correct that graph, I don't have an answer for that yet. I can say to you in honesty, though, it's unsustainable if unaddressed. So today, on behalf of all the parish, I'm just making a simple appeal to you. I'll preface this with the view of all of us, the Pastoral Council, everyone, that we would not and do not wish anyone to place unnecessary burden on their own family. We understand budget pressure on everyone in Australia today, every organisation, every business, every household. So please, this is not addressed to you in a way that would be something impossible for you. It is addressed, however, if it is possible, if you need a guide, if people could think about, could I give one cup of coffee a week extra to the parish? I don't want 100 cups of coffee. But if you could see your way clear to increasing contributions by about that volume, we'll go some way towards reducing that margin between income and expenditure. Now, I know I'm appealing to the people who are already on side and already generous, but the reality is that. If you are a regular giving in a regular manner, could you consider then an increase to that amount, if that's possible for you? If you attend St. Paul's or St. Grateful's churches for your masses, would you consider making a commitment to the parish, becoming a regular donor? If you're a wage earner, could you consider becoming a donor as well to the parish? You're helping each other and you're helping every person in church today and all those who can't come here. And if you're following us online regularly or temporarily unable to attend Mass, could you continue to support the parish with a donation? There's lots of ways we can contribute. There's the planned giving program, which is traditionally the envelopes. There's the collections. There's tap and go, and it's possible through the parish office to make arrangements for direct debit. Something would come out regularly from your income, your wages, or your bank account without anything needing to be done. If we just stay with the coffee image for a moment, if we all contribute, if we all did something, a small thing, it would make a big difference. Not asking people to make unnecessary sacrifices, but if it's possible, as I say, we have to work to bridge that gap. We can do our best to reduce expenditure, but we also have to increase our income. We want to live our vision, and we want to be an inclusive Catholic community. We want to connect people to God and to each other. Just as Jesus said, love God, love your neighbour. That's at the heart of our parish. We want to live that vision in our mission. Be faithful to the gospel. Be true to our tradition. Take the best you can from our inspiration as Passionists. We want to become a welcoming, diverse community with a good focus on inclusion and equality. And we want to bring people to God and God to people through our sacraments and our liturgies, so that we can have an outward-looking view. We can be stewards of God's creation. We can commit ourselves to social justice. We can provide spiritual nourishment. We can be hospitable to others. All these hopes and desires are wonderful and real, but they also, and they need presence, and they need generosity, and they need our work, but also they have to be underpinned by finances as well. Some of our future goals: we want to build up a faith formation, adult education program in the parish. We want to, in the midst of all this COVID, to try to work our best to rebuild a sense of community and belonging. I understand people are still hesitant, and a lot of people still not returning, but we want to begin that process of trying to reach out. We want to continue our social, environmental outreach, and all of that will depend on generosity from everyone. So thank you for listening, and it's not easy to speak about it. I'd rather talk about the gospel, I'm sure Father Tony would. But I feel, unless I share this with you now, I'm not being fair to you, because I don't want it to just come as a terrible surprise next year. And so let's do our best to see what we can do. Thank you.
Let's stand then and profess, pardon me, our faith in our God with this ancient creed. But remember that we're professing our faith in the God who gives and gives and gives. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. And there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, so we are inspired by the example of the tax collector in today's gospel. We come humbly before our God, raising our prayers and our requests.
We pray that the church may always be a home for people seeking forgiveness and right relationship with God and others. Lord, hear us. We pray that leaders may govern with authority grounded in humility, putting the needs of others before their own. Lord, hear us. that leaders may that we pray also that all gathered here might put aside our judgments of others and see each person as an image of the invisible God. Lord, hear us.
Lord, hear our prayer.
And we pray that those who gathered for the diocesan assembly last Friday and yesterday will bring the fruits of discernment, discussion and reflection to our parish for all to share. Lord, hear us.
Lord, hear our prayer.
And we pray for the sick of our parish and for those who care for them. We pray for those who have died recently and also for those whose anniversaries occur about this time. Lord, hear us.
Lord, hear our prayer. Merciful God, you do hear our prayers. We ask you to fill us with your kindness that we may be joyful and glad all our days. We offer our prayers to you as always through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
So that you might love in us what you loved in your Son, by whose obedience we have been restored to those gifts of yours that by sinning we had lost in disobedience.
So, Lord, with all the angels and saints, we too give you thanks, as in exaltation we acclaim.
Holy, holy,
that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread and, giving you thanks, broke it, gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when the supper was ended, he took the chalice. Once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for all, for the forgiveness of sins." Then he said to them, "Whenever you do this, do it in memory of me." Mystery of our faith.
We proclaim your death, O Lord, and profess your resurrection until we come again. We proclaim your death, O Lord, and profess your resurrection.
Celebrate this memorial of his death and resurrection. We offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have counted us worthy to be in your presence and to minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be brought together into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the whole world. Bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis, our Pope, Patrick, our Bishop, the clergy, and all your faithful people. Remember all our sisters and brothers who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. We remember Anna particularly this morning. Welcome them to the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, Saint Joseph, the apostles, and all your saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may be co-heirs to eternal life. May praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. For through him and with him and in him, O God Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. Together in the prayer that Jesus gave us, we pray it with Christ himself. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and give us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil, and graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Saviour Jesus Christ. For the kingdom, power, and glory are yours now and forever. Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you." Look not on our shared sinfulness, but on the faith, the trust of your people. Graciously grant us peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign for ever and ever.
Amen. Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with all of you.
And with your spirit.
Let's offer to each other and receive from each other that peace of Christ. Peace in This is for us Jesus Christ, who is the only source of faith and of hope and of love. Happy are those who are called in to share in this supper.
Lord, I am with you, Jesus Christ, and I know you.
Yes, I'm going to believe it. Lord, we ask you to bring to its fullness the communion we share in this sacrament. May our celebration this morning have an effect in our lives through Christ our Lord. Amen.
And our announcements for this weekend. If you have not already done so, please complete the parish census form and place it in the box provided at the entrance of the church. And if you have not attended a child safe environment 90-minute training session, please attend one of the sessions that are on offer as per the information in the bulletin. And also see the bulletin for details of where the next home rosary and mass will take place. And the Passionist icon, which was on display here in this church last weekend and during the week, it will be on display at St. Raphael's Church this coming week. And again, please see the bulletin for the details of that. Thank you.
Thanks, Ros. The Lord be with you. May Almighty God bless all of us, bless those whom we love, and bless those whom we struggle to love. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Our Eucharist is ended. Let's go. Live this day in faith and hope and love. Thanks be to God.
If any children would like to come up and help us with the percussion, that would be most...
Oh yes, any children would like to come up.
My soul is praising the Lord, and glad for all he is giving, because of the love that remembered me. Oh,